Please join us as we sing "Here I Am to Worship" and "In Jesus' Name Above All Names."
As God has blessed us in so many ways, let's return our blessings now to our Creator.
Thank you.
I was remiss in mentioning one sad thing. A longtime member, Bob Chambers, passed away quietly on Thursday, and there is a visitation for him at the McKinley Funeral Home this afternoon from 2 to 4 p.m. and then 7 to 9 in the evening, and the memorial service is tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock, and I'll be conducting that. So we offer our condolences to Bob, and I don't know if you remember Bob and Lily were here when I first began. Just a fun couple. We offer our condolences to the family. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. God of love, here we are on this cold, wintry day. Yet while our bodies might feel the effects of frigid temperatures, our souls are not affected as much, because we are here in your loving presence. Here we are conscious of all that you do for us, of the love that you have expressed in the Son you sent to die for us, a love expressed by the warm welcome we received when we came in. Here we are gathered together so that we can lay ourselves aside, focus on you, and by doing so, receive what it is that we need from you so that we can be made whole, so that we can feel better about ourselves, so that we can be healed of our sins, so that we can forgive as we have been forgiven. As we enter into the season of Lent, we symbolically gather together at the table with Jesus, sitting down to be fed body, mind, and soul, joining together to know the blessing of his presence, forming a community that reflects your grace and mercy. Bless us, God, with your forgiveness. Bless us, Holy Spirit, with the power to repent. Bless us, Jesus, with your wisdom and teaching. Hear us, God, for we gather at the table and pray in Jesus' name, sharing the very words of prayer he first taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our Sunday school is on to work. And Bob McGregor is going to share our readings.
Reading is John 13, verses 1 to 5. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him.
I invite you to join me in our Lenten liturgy. And please don't use the liturgies that are printed in the bulletin. Use the overhead long with others. I've modified the liturgy a little bit to better suit our readings, but I wanted you to have the information from Presbyterian World Service and Development just as a reminder of the great work that they're doing. So please join me. In the days of old, God made a covenant with humanity and all creatures of the earth, a forever promise. We respond, is it up there? Oh, okay. Try after. Leave it out. Try just going after the servant song then. Maybe I left it out. No luck? Okay. Well then I will lead you in it, and you can follow along roughly in the printed bulletin. Sorry about that. Boy, I started on time and something else goes wrong. In the days of old, God made a covenant with humanity and all creatures of the earth, a forever promise. We respond by trusting in God, who guides us and teaches us how to live. God sent Jesus to live and die for this world. Throughout his ministry, Jesus proclaimed the kingdom of God. We respond by his way. God sees in us the rainbow light of his own love and mercy, rather than through the dark cloud of our flawed ways. We respond by seeing those around us through the light of God's love, rather than through the cloud of our own self-interest. Let's pray. God of love and mercy, your rainbow in the clouds reminds us to share your love as we have experienced it. Give us the strength to follow you, even amid the temptations of our everyday lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to sing.
Thank you.
We're in the season of Lent. Now, if you didn't grow up in the Catholic or the Anglican Church, you might not entirely know what the season is about. So the season of Lent is 40 days of repentance, prayer, atonement, forgiveness, and forgiving. It's a traditional time in the Roman and the Anglican Church for folks to think about their journey to Easter. Now, the word Lent itself was actually stolen from Old England, from Old English. It's an abbreviation of the word lengthen. And what happened was the church, as Easter approached, saw pagan festivals celebrating the spring. And they realized that the season of Easter was also a spring-like celebration. So they decided to offer their church folks an alternate way of preparing for spring, one that combined their faith and this celebration of the new life that would come at spring. So the season of Lent and these 40 days is actually a journey from the darkness of winter to the joy of spring. Except in our case, in the Christian church, it's the darkness of sin to the joy of Jesus' forgiveness and resurrection and the new life that we have in him. Now, as I said earlier, the Passover meal was recorded by John and has a very thorough discussion of what Jesus said to his disciples. So, as we gather here, we start at the beginning. And right at the beginning, Jesus drew his disciples, sat around the table, and started off in an unusual way. He started by stripping down just to his skivvies and washing his disciples' feet. Now, why would he do that? Why would you start the Passover meal by bending down to your disciples? Well, you have to understand that the ritual of washing one's feet was a way of welcoming people. When a stranger or a guest came into your house, if you really wanted to make them feel welcome, you washed their feet. So Jesus, in washing his disciples' feet, was making them feel welcome. That was one aspect of it. The other aspect was that Jesus was making himself as a servant. Jesus was teaching his disciples that even a leader, even one who was in charge, had to take on that role of serving others. That the role of leadership was not one of superiority that excluded you, but rather one of responsibility that you shared with the others and included you. So there are these two aspects, this ritual cleansing, this welcoming, and this idea that Jesus was, in effect, just like his followers. But when he got up from the meal, he said a curious thing. He said, "Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him." So, on the one hand, he's demonstrating himself to be a servant, but at the same time, he's reminding his disciples of his role, that he is indeed their master. And there's a curious balance here. There's a curious balance that is presented by Jesus, that he is still in charge, but he's also a servant. So how does that work out? Well, we have to go back a paragraph. We have to understand what it is that Jesus was doing. And John introduces the discussion this way. Jesus knew the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. So here's this servant, here's this master, who is demonstrating his love even to the end, to the cross, all the way to the end for him, also perhaps even to the end of time, perhaps beyond eternity. But what Jesus is doing here is framed in this love. This meal, we are gathered at the table with Jesus, is not about teaching. It's not about commissioning. It's not about any of the technical terms that you might think of the relationship between Jesus and his disciples. It's about love. So for the next 6 or so weeks, we're going to be talking about Jesus' love. That's going to be the underlying message here. Now, what does that love mean for us? Well, there are a couple of things that we're going to do today to really cement Jesus' love for us. The first thing is to celebrate communion. We are actually going to eat with Jesus. And we're going to do so in the tradition that Jesus would have known in his day. You know, the little cups and the tiny cubes of bread? Well, that's a fairly recent innovation. By recent, I mean by about 150 or 200 years old, but it's a fairly recent innovation. When Jesus was at the table with his disciples, the way they would have done it would be with one common cup and breaking the bread as they passed it around and dipping. It's what the fancy word is intinction. But it's actually the original way that Jesus served communion. So we're going to follow that original tradition because we are at the table of Jesus. We're trying to reenact that. But the communion meal isn't just about eating with Jesus. It's recognizing two things. It's recognizing that Jesus and humanity are of the same element, represented in the blood, in the bread. Jesus said, "This is my body," when he handed out the bread. And it's not as if the bread magically turns into flesh and blood. It's a symbol. He says that as you eat this, then you are knowing my body. My body is part of you. My body physically nourishes you. We are one. And then he says, the wine is the blood of the new covenant. Now, in the ritual that took place before communion was given to us, there was blood sacrifices. Right? Animals were slaughtered, and the blood was poured on the altar. So when Jesus said, this is the blood of the new covenant, he says two things. He says, first off, I am the only one who can die for your sins. That's the first thing. This is his blood as an atonement for our sin. But the second thing is that we don't need to do this anymore with blood. From now on, the blessed wine is good enough. No animal sacrifice. Jesus makes one sacrifice once and for all on the cross. It was done, it was over with. Now we remember it symbolically. So these are symbols of Jesus' sacrifice, symbols of Jesus' unity with us, symbols of the forgiveness that comes only through Jesus. The other thing about this table is that it is a reminder, especially when we come and take the bread and wine, it is a reminder that we have been forgiven and that we are to forgive. This is the deal. We have to forgive if we are to be forgiven. Jesus teaches us what in the Lord's Prayer? Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgiveness is a two-way street. And this meal, the fact that we do this together, now if we were actually gathered at the table, if we were seated around a monstrous table, what we would have is we would have the plate of bread and we would pass it from person to person. And that would be a reminder as you pass it to the next person, to the next person. That would be a reminder not only that this is Jesus' body broken for us, but also that we're sharing this body, that this matters, that we're held in unity through this bread. And the same thing with the cup as it passes from person to person. It doesn't just mean that Jesus is forgiving us as we receive the cup. I like to think of it as the cup goes from person to person, that as you pass it to me and I pass it to the next person, you're saying to me, I forgive you as you give me the cup. And I thank you and I say, I'm forgiven, thank you. And then I forgive the person that's next to me, and it goes around that way. So there is this sense of forgiveness that needs to transcend whatever it is that's gone on in our lives, that we share this together at this table. Ultimately, what this table is a blessing to all of us. A physical reminder of our relationship with Jesus, of his love for us. Also, a physical reminder of the service that we offer to one another. In this case, we're not gathered around the table, so we're not actually passing it around. But you can think of me being the channel for today. Just as Jesus was the channel at that first meal, today I'm the channel representing each of us serving one another. So receive this meal. Be at the table of Jesus. Imagine him teaching you. Imagine him saying this to you. No servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. We are not superior to one another. We are equals. I have a certain role, you have a certain role. In some cases, you are the one who leads. In some cases, you are the one who follows. But all of us are following, are sitting together, whether it's here in the church, wherever we are. We can imagine ourselves being one with Jesus, being at the table with him, today and forevermore. Amen. Now we're going to sing. join me in our communion liturgy. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy and eat. We come to receive God's kindness and blessings. We gather to share God's grace and generosity. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. We come to rest in God's presence and support. We gather to share God's renewal and refreshing. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. We come to remember and honor our Savior, Jesus Christ. We gather to share his pleasure and love. God, we gather at your table with hope and anticipation, fear and trepidation, courage and determination. You have set before us a great bounty, bread and wine, simple fruits of the earth, not the product of our labor, but the gifts of your love, grace, and mercy. You have set before us a table full of miracles, Christ's presence, a new deal, the Spirit's work, and your forgiveness. You have spread before us a table of responsibility and ministry, giving as generously as you constantly provide for us, loving as lavishly as you always love us, blessing others faithfully and joyfully, simply because we can. As we prepare ourselves to receive Christ's heavenly blessing, help us give and exchange our earthly deeds, casting away all that is impure and unworthy, offering you souls cleansed in the waters of baptism and redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Gracious God, you spoke, and by your word you created us. You breathed, and by your Spirit gave us life. You thought, and by your grace you gave us wisdom. You saw us struggle, and you took mercy on us. You heard us rebel against you, and you forgave us. What can we do in response but join with the heavenly choir that praises you, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, Hosanna, we are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Faithful God, in this holy feast of bread, we remember that all that you did through Jesus. We remember he promised new life, that he would never leave us, and that he would make us your children. Thank you for making us as one in Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for showing us Jesus in this meal. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for us so that we might rise to new life with you, a mystery beyond understanding, expressed in these ancient words. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. God, bless this bread and wine, these words and actions, and all those gathered in Jesus' name. Open our hearts to feel his love, our bodies to feel his presence, and our minds to know his forgiveness. On the night before he died, Jesus took bread, broke it, gave thanks, and said, Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup, saying, This cup is a new promise sealed in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Now I'm going to invite my service to come help. Move this chair out of the way. And I'll invite you to come forward. There is bread and grape juice to my right, and bread and real wine on this side. So you can have your choice which you would like to take. So please come forward and share in our communion. And if you'd rather sit, we can deliver.
Here, take this.
No, that's okay. I don't. I got a little. There's a little piece in my finger. I need.
I'll take that one.
Do you make another piece?
Oh, that's okay. I had some on my finger.
I think you made it worse than I do.
This is the body and blood of Christ, broken and shed for you. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Let's pray together. God, as we have shared the wine and broken bread together, let us feel souls of your blessed joy, the joy that comes from being your beloved children, the joy that comes from sharing Christ's care and kindness, the joy of knowing that Jesus will return soon. As we leave this place and go out into the world on our own, let us work, pray, love, and serve one another in our own way. As we have felt and heard and seen and tasted Christ Jesus, let our hands offer Christ's healing and joy to the world. Let our voices speak Christ's truth, justice, and mercy. Let our faces reveal the joy of knowing Christ to everyone we meet. And let our very lives be as an example of all that is good and Christ-like. Hear us, for it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And please rise for our final benediction. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And together we say, Amen.